Okay. We're going to go ahead and start. And we're removing the scar that she has from her previous cesarean. So we leave her with a nice looking incision. Sometimes there can be a lot of scar tissue here. But this is looking pretty normal. Second knife, retractor for Dr. Hoffer. Okay. Need some scissors. Pickups. Looks good. We're just opening onto the muscle.
Hookers, please.
And we'll peel off this connective tissue that's on top of the muscle so that we can get inside. Try not to cut the muscle because you need that to move. Okay. And we'll do that down below the incision. Take that. A couple of Mayo clamps next. Okay, swell. We're going to separate the muscles in the middle. Great. Now this, at this point, we're going to open into the abdomen, and we want to make sure we don't cut the intestines or the bladder. And there we are. Scissors. Okay. And there's the bladder real close. Pickups. Now I need to remove the bladder from on the uterus. Okay. And after we move the bladder, then we can get the baby out. And we'll just make a opening there. And there's the baby's head. Hopefully all everything out. Little pressure, Dr. Hoffer, and it's just like a natural childbirth. That white stuff on the baby is called vernix. It's like cold cream. And here's the shoulder. What's that? And there's the other shoulder, and we have a nice baby girl. And we clamp off the baby's umbilical cord. And then Dr. Tomlinson will take care of the little girl. It's the girl! It worked! She asked for a girl. Okay, we need the pit. What we're going to do now is remove the placenta from inside the uterus. We'll kind of massage the uterus a little bit so that when the placenta comes out, there isn't any extra bleeding. I always feel sorry for the placenta because early on in the development of the baby, one group of cells decided to be the baby and the other group of cells decided to be the placenta. One gets to be president, and one goes to the office.
What lab? We'll
bring her over to see you guys in a minute, okay?
Bladder blade. And now, after all the excitement, we've got to put this all back together. One more sponge stick. Right there in the middle. Here's a little membrane.
Hi, Lynn.
two tapes there, Dr. Hoffman.
I have one here.
Is there one inside?
I'll
check it. There's none inside. Hey, you're happy. Yeah. Super. Just
one other doctor's good to speak.
Whoops. I got caught, huh?
Check okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
It's okay. Yeah, she looks good sized.
Okay.
Cherries.
Okay. Okay. Oh. 100 years ago or so, when they had to do cesareans, they didn't bother sewing the uterus back up. They just leave it outside the abdomen because infections were such a problem. That was the only way they could survive. But now, we know about washing our hands, which is probably one of the biggest advancements medicine ever had. Okay. Suture scissors. Just cut the needle. Second row. I think we can do a nice Lambert stitch along there.
She got the wrong.
Yeah, she's got a probably got her lungs inflated really well. Well, she's just not ready yet. Unfortunately, when we take her to the nursery.
And one more little stitch over on the side here. I think it looks good. Let's try it now. One here. Let me have a little piece of that. Just a little.
No, she just has a lot of mucus and it's the same. They can't breathe in their tummy. They have to go through a lot of changes when they start doing all the breathing and their heart does all the beating. So. They kind of grunt and strain and cry, which is normal.
It's got long fingers.
Trying to resist all the
problems.
And that should do it fine. I think that's got it. That's it. 2-0. Pickups. Now, since we took the bladder off of the uterus, we have to put it back on. Well, I guess you don't have to, but we're sort of used to it. I got suture scissors for Dr. Hoffer.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Got my suture.
Go by their dad and tell him.
The nurse came out and told us. Yeah. Oh, little doll. What did it mean? He has a sister.
Thank you. weighs 6 pounds, 6 ounces. 2.91 kilos. Already examined her. You can have her just a second.
Lisa will be able to wear your bikini again after this.
Dr. Stutes, that was a fascinating demonstration. Not really a demonstration. That was the real thing, and that just to me is great to see. I hope our viewers appreciated the time you spent preparing that. The patient's family really had a lot of courage to let us do that. Very, very nice. One more question before we close. How do you make the decision what type of cut to make in the skin? Women are always concerned about the scars showing, well, men are too, but in this case, of course, women. How do you make that decision?
Well, there's a real controversy in obstetrics about the way that incision should go. As you can see in that operation, I did the bikini incision. It also is called a Fannin steel. A lot of doctors do a vertical or up and down.
That's the
incision.
One I'm used to seeing.
Exactly. It's their feeling that they can get more room using an up and down incision as opposed to the bikini incision. But my experience of 4 years of residency and over 800 cesarean sections,
800,
wow. 800, I had no occasion when I could not deliver babies through a bikini incision. As a matter of fact, the largest baby I delivered through a bikini incision was about 14 pounds.
Gosh.
That was a large
child.
Large child.
Well, it's interesting that the part of the operation that the women remember most is the scar. I mean, that's what I see when they come in my office. They're always asking about the scar. And you want to make that look as good as possible. So using that technique, you really can.
It's true. And I have to give credit to some plastic surgeons that I met during my medical school training back in Michigan who taught me how to do a particularly nice stitch.
Great. Well, thanks again for that superb demonstration tonight. Really enjoyed that. Special mention must also be made to the staff of the surgery department at Fremont for their very thoughtful assistance with this production. On upcoming Medical Explorer programs, I will take you to a home-style childbirth, as well as to what some people might call a routine vaginal-type delivery at the hospital. So please join us every Tuesday and Friday. I'd like to invite you to write to me at my dermatology and allergy offices in Yuba City with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see on this program. The Medical Explorer, as you know, is a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the Skin and Allergy Center of Yuba City at 367 Del Norte Avenue, Yuba City 95991. In my next program, The Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of more interesting frontiers of medical care practices in the Yuba City, Marysville area. Till next time, I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your Medical Explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight, and have a good evening.
Dr. Hub area.
Good evening and welcome to another edition of the Yuba Sutter Medical Explorer. My name is Dr. Robert Peppercorn and my specialties are dermatology and allergy. I serve as host of this program. The purpose of the Medical Explorer is to explore the medical communities of Yuba and Sutter counties and to take you behind the scenes of medical care practices right here in our local area. We bring you another interesting program tonight as our Medical Explorer Channel 5 cameras take us into the offices of Bi-County Radiology in Yuba City, where we will observe the operation of a new mammography X-ray machine. This fascinating device can detect breast cancer earlier than any other technique available in modern medicine. We will also meet with one of our area's most highly skilled specialists in the field of radiology, who will explain more about his work in detecting one of our most feared groups of diseases. This, of course, is the group of diseases called cancer. Before getting to our topic tonight, let's take a look at the latest medical news. Drinking caffeine while under stress raises blood pressure and intensifies the effects of stress on the heart, a new study shows. Duke University researchers measured the blood pressure of 33 healthy male college students before they drank any coffee and again during a mathematics competition after they drank 2 to 3 cups. In this type of study, common physical reactions are significant, even if the number of subjects is small. The study found that stress forced blood pressure up an average of 7 millimeters. Stress combined with drinking coffee pushed up blood pressure an average of 10 millimeters. This type of blood pressure increase could be dangerous to people who already have high blood pressure, according to the authors of the study. My next medical news story concerns a new operation for nearsightedness. Recent studies have announced that a controversial new operation to correct nearsightedness is safe and effective. But doctors say the operation, called radical keratotomy, is not for all the United States' 15 million nearsighted people. It's still not the treatment of choice, and contact lenses and glasses continue to be the major way to correct nearsightedness. Two studies released at a recent annual meeting of the American Academy of Ophthalmology show the operation, which involves cutting very tiny slits in the cornea of the eye, to be effective in 80% of nearsighted people with only minor complications. The operation worked best for those with minimal nearsightedness. However, experts say that many people's eyes continue to change as they age, and some degree of nearsightedness may return. And doctors still can't predict which patients the procedure will work for and which it won't work for. The procedure can be done in a doctor's office, takes anywhere from 10 to 20 minutes, and costs about $1,500. My final medical news story tonight concerns the continuing frightening disease called AIDS. Drug-abusing mothers who are otherwise healthy have spread AIDS to their babies, providing the first documented evidence that carriers of the suspected AIDS virus can pass it on to others even though they have no symptoms, according to researchers at Cornell Medical Center. They suspect that antibodies made by the body to combat the virus are ineffective. If so, this could complicate the effort to produce a vaccine against AIDS. Researchers now believe that people might be carrying the disease without actually having symptoms. Unfortunately, these people are capable of transmitting the AIDS disease to someone else. This distressing news was reported in a recent issue of the New England Journal of Medicine. My health tip tonight concerns one of the most dangerous forms of all types of cancer. This type of cancer is called malignant melanoma. Most human beings have moles or brown spots on their skin, sometimes perceived as beauty marks. They are growths or clusters of cells containing a pigment called melanin, produced by the skin. Usually the growths are harmless. However, some moles and other skin growths have the potential to develop into a special type of cancer called malignant melanoma. Although it emerges on the surface of the skin, melanoma may spread over time to other organs in the body. In this way, melanoma can be fatal. While anyone can develop melanoma, dermatologists have identified several key factors. The first factor is complexion. Melanoma most often occurs in fair-skinned people with blonde or red hair and blue eyes. Individuals with dark complexions are less vulnerable. The second factor is age. Men and women over the age of 30 are most vulnerable. Heredity also plays an important role. Melanoma has been linked to genetics. A family history of melanoma increases the individual's risk. Finally, sun exposure, the time of sun exposure favors development of malignant melanoma. Consistent overexposure to solar radiation may trigger melanoma. Dermatologists urge people to avoid long-term excessive sunbathing and also urge them to use sunscreen protection lotions. Melanoma most often emerges in pre-existing moles or brown spots. They are more common on the head and neck, but may appear anywhere on the body, particularly on women's arms and legs and on men's backs and chest. Since early diagnosis is the key to effective treatment, dermatologists urge patients to closely monitor existing moles and other dark areas, watching for the following symptoms and signs.